So let's take a look at radical chlorination. This is where an alkane can be chlorinated via a radical mechanism. So remember before we discussed that one of the types of covalent bonds that will readily undergo homolytic bond cleavage is a halogen-halogen bond. So given a certain amount of heat or a kind of a photon of UV light that is going to promote homolysis, this Cl2 molecule can dissociate into two chlorine radicals. So this is the initiation step because we have a covalent species going to two radical species. Now, what can happen here is a chlorine radical is a pretty unstable species, and so many radicals are. So that's what can be so deleterious when radicals interact with our DNA and other biological systems. So a radical can find an alkane and is going to propagate the existence of other radicals because of its own instability. And so what happens here, let's say it finds a molecule of methane or some other hydrocarbon, it can propagate the existence of an alkyl radical by this process. So here's a carbon-hydrogen covalent bond. So one of these electrons will go here, and a hydrogen radical will now make a covalent bond with chlorine, giving us HCl, and leaving us with, in this case, a methyl radical, which can be very unstable. And so that means that now that we have a methyl radical swimming around, if it finds another molecule of chlorine, it is going to propagate further and go ahead and form a carbon-chlorine bond, leaving a new chlorine radical. And so this is our chlorinated product, and in this case was generated in a propagation step. It is just as well that a carbon radical could have found a chlorine radical, and then the chloromethane could have been generated in a termination step. So there's a lot of ways for this to go, but in this case we drew it as a propagation step. And then any two radical species that you could find in this system, whether it was two chlorine radicals, two methyl radicals, a chlorine and a methyl radical, as we just said, if any of those were to collide, then they would form a covalent structure in a termination step. So basically here, to make this, let's just remind ourselves, we're forming chlorine radicals. The chlorine radical is going to propagate some alkyl radical, and then the alkyl radical will want to bind to anything it can find. So if it runs into a chlorine molecule, which is probably much more prevalent in the system than chlorine radicals, being very unstable, then it will go ahead and form the monochlorine product. Now, the monochlorinated product can then go ahead and react further. If this structure comes into contact with another chlorine radical, that chlorine radical can strip away another one of those three protons, leaving another radical that can get another chlorine. So then we could have a dichlorinated or a trichlorinated or even tetrachlorinated. So we could have tetrachloromethane. And so that's how halogenation works for alkanes. It's going to have to be a radical mechanism with initiation, propagation, and termination, as we see. Now, another thing that we got to understand about these radical mechanisms, remember when we were looking at, let's say, an SN1 reaction, where we had the sp2 hybridized trigonal planar carbocation intermediate, we had to be aware of the possibility for a racemic mixture, because when you have a planar situation like this, and recalling that a carbon radical is also planar and sp2 hybridized, that means that, let's say we have this carbon radical, and let's say we have three different groups here. Let's say they're just three different alkyl groups. So that means we have the potential to form a stereocenter if that carbon binds to, forms a bond to a new group. And so let's say we have a chlorine molecule. Let's say the chlorine molecule is going to approach from the top, and then we're going to generate a carbon-chlorine bond. The other chlorine radical will go away. So we have a new carbon-chlorine bond. So there that is here. But then let's say, similarly, it could approach from the bottom, and then the chlorine would now be on the bottom here. Well, these three different groups dictate that we have formed a new stereocenter. So we have to be aware of the possibility of forming a racemic mixture of enantiomers when we are looking at radical mechanisms. So that describes the halogenation. Now, the other thing that we have to understand about halogenation is that a free radical halogenation can potentially be a very Regius selective process. And so what we want to understand here is that bromination ends up looking to be very, very Regius Selective, because let's say we're going to do a bromination on isobutane. Okay, so there are four possible locations for a bromine atom to end up. And as it turns out, we get strictly bromination on this location here. So we get the tertiary system. Now, chlorination ends up not being so Regius Selective. We actually get a mixture of the tertiary and the primary chloroalkane. So we want to try to understand why that might be, because we want to be able to predict product mixtures, right? So the key here lies in two things. Number one, we want to understand the difference in the stability between the bromine radical and the chlorine radical. Well, just as alkyl radicals follow alkyl cation stability, also, halogen radicals follow halogen anion stability trends. So because bromine is a larger atom than chlorine, it can better accommodate the deficiency. Okay, it's a larger atom, so that's more diffuse around a larger volume. And so because the bromine radical can better accommodate the instability, or in other words, it's not as unstable as the chlorine radical is, it can wait and follow the lowest energy pathway. And that means that it is stable enough to follow a pathway that generates the lowest energy intermediate. And so that means that a bromine radical is more likely to go ahead and extract this implied hydrogen here, generating the more stable tertiary alkyl radical there. That is the more favorable pathway. That is a lower energy intermediate than the other possibility. So bromine isn't really going to go that way because of its enhanced stability due to its size, okay? And so that means if that were much more frequently producing the tertiary alkyl radical intermediate, that means that when a bromine is added, it's going to add in that position because that's where the radical is. And so that's why we're going to get almost exclusively the tertiary bromoalkane. Now with chlorine, because the chlorine radical is much less stable, it's going to kind of go for whatever hydrogen it can get. It wants to satisfy the instability of being a radical. And so no matter where it collides with this molecule, it's going to extract whatever hydrogen it can get, even if it ends up generating the less stable primary alkyl radical intermediate. And so that is why we see a lot less Regius selectivity with chlorination, because of the size. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. And as always, feel free to email me with questions, professordaveexplains@gmail.com.